Who are you?
Hi, I'm Dr. David Roby.
And you are, what's your job right now?
Right now, I work at the Shenzhen Houda Academy in Shenzhen, China. It's in Guangdong Province, right next to Hong Kong. And I'm the school's, it's a high school, I'm the school's Spanish teacher, and I'm also the director of institutional research.
That's fantastic. And you were, previously, you were professor of Spanish here at the University of Pikeville.
Yes, sir.
I wonder, David Roby as a kid, did you say, man, I'm going to teach language in China? Maybe not. What did you want to do as a kid?
Well, when I was a kid, I had absolutely no idea I would end up in China. If someone would have told me 10 years ago that I was going to end up in China, I would have thought that they needed to be committed. When I was a kid, I had a few different ideas. For a while, when I was a little kid, I wanted to be a basketball player when I grew up. And that dream lasted about 5 minutes. And for a while, I wanted to be an electrical engineer. And I loved working with radios and electronics. I would buy electronic kits from Radio Shack, and I would try to build radios and do different experiments with those. I'd like to take things apart and see how they worked. And I was really interested in radio, ham radio, CB radio, that kind of thing. I love listening to shortwave. I loved hearing different languages on shortwave and looking for different stations around the world. But I was not very good at math, so I didn't become an engineer. So that kind of fell through. But I always thought it was interesting whenever I'd watch, for example, like the Miss Universe pageant, and I would watch the interpreters, and I thought it was really cool watching how people could interact and speak in different languages. I really thought that was fascinating. That really tickled my brain. So I just thought that would be kind of cool to do. So for a while, I wanted to be an interpreter.
Hmm. So obviously, you've had some interesting jobs, either, you know, as a researcher, academic, to professor, to now even international professor, international instructor. When you think about dream job, is there a dream job out there for you?
I'm not sure. I really enjoy what I'm doing now. I love teaching. I love to write. I love to teach. I love to write. And I love the one-on-one interaction with students, with learners. And I get to do that now. As far as a dream job goes, you know, working at a high school is very hard work. Being a teacher is hard work. And no matter what anyone says. And I think sometimes we, as educators, we get sandbagged by, you know, bureaucracy, politics, and red tape, things like that. And I think it would just be nice to, I don't know, for me to be able to do what I'm doing, but maybe just have a little bit more freedom. But at the same time, you know, maintain some structure. So I work best when I have freedom, when I have autonomy. But I also need structure, or I'll just kind of maybe not do much.
So, did anything happen in life that spurred you on towards this heart of a teacher, this educational path?
As far as being a teacher goes, when I was growing up, I was not really a good student. In fact, I hated school, and my grades were not always that good. I was not a bad kid necessarily, and I was not a rotten student, but I just did not like school. I did not like getting up early and being stuck in a building all day and having to go home and do more work associated with that building at night. I just didn't handle that very well. So I never wanted to be a teacher. I just could not imagine being a teacher. I figured, you know, as soon as I'm done with this, that's it. But when I was working on my bachelor's degree in Spanish at West Virginia University, I became friends with a master's student. His name was B.J. Behringer. He's from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and he and I became really good friends. And he was a graduate instructor of Spanish, and he was just on fire for teaching. And he would just talk about how excited he would be to teach his class. And I would watch him teach his class, and it was just, it was amazing. It was like watching a, you know, watching a coach, like a football coach with X's and O's on the board. And he would use these motivational quotes, and he would just get so excited and just so fired up. And he would talk to me about teaching, and it just, I just got so excited about it. And he made teaching seem like the coolest thing in the world. So that's really what got me interested in teaching.
So in one sentence, would you be able to summarize your call or purpose in a sentence?
In one sentence? I can try. I think my calling is to encourage people to take charge of their own learning, to become independent learners, and to think for themselves. And also, it's still one sentence. And also to promote peace and goodwill through intercultural exchange.
So with that call that you have, do you feel like your current job helps you with that or aligns with that purpose?
I think it works perfectly. I think it aligns with that purpose perfectly. I'm living and working in China, and China is on the other side of the planet, and most Americans in the U.S. don't really know anything about China. Most people don't get the opportunity to go there. It's not cheap to go there. It's like we hear stuff on the news about China, but until you really go there and spend time there and experience what life is like there with regular everyday people, you won't really understand what it's like. So I think one thing that I get to do in China is I get to share my experiences with people here in the U.S. And I get to answer their questions and help people understand better, you know, what it's like over there. And on the other side of that, in China, I get to teach, Chinese high school students. And I just, for some reason, I just really, really love doing it. And I feel like I'm really good at it. And I get to teach these kids how to be independent learners, how to think for themselves, how to do research, and for them to discover what their calling is, and for them to better understand how the world works. In other countries and in the United States, but even within their own country. I feel like I used to work here at UPike, and I feel like there's a lot of misunderstanding in this country about, for example, Appalachia. A lot of people don't know much about this place, and they have some, bizarre misconceptions that, promoted by the media, some more malicious than others. And, I think I'd like to let people know this is who we are, and this is what we do, and, we're just regular people, and we're just trying to, doing the best we can, and we're good people, and, it's the same thing in China. There are rural areas in China and there are cities in China, and you have this rural urban dichotomy, this division in just about any country in the world. And I think that cultural exchange, promoting peace and understanding through cultural exchange, it's not just between different countries, it's between just different parts of the same country. And I feel that I've been able to do that in China, and I just love doing that. I think it's great. I just want people to just be the best they can be, just to achieve their potential.
So you've been influential as a teacher, as a colleague, but let's talk about people who've been influential to you. Who's been most influential in helping you understand this call in your own life?
I can think of several people. One person that had an influence on me, whether she realized it or not, was my grandmother, my maternal grandmother. She was Italian. Her parents came to the U.S. from Italy at the turn of last century, and she was a great woman. She was awesome, and she had an Italian textbook on her shelf, on the shelf. My grandparents had this Italian textbook I think it was called The First Book of Italian, and it's a really old book. I still have it, and it was on my grandparents' bookshelf. And every once in a while, she would, you know, if it was like kind of like, you know, after we had our big dinner, and it was kind of like maybe sort of late in the day, you know, it was before, you know, she'd go cook again or go out in the garden or do whatever she did. She'd pull out that book, and she would read to us out of the book. She would teach us words and expressions, you know, buongiorno, you know, things like that, and molto bene. And she would, come stai? You know, she would read. She'd teach us these phrases out of the book, and she'd have us repeat them. And some of the grandkids, you know, some of them enjoyed it, but no one enjoyed it more than I did. And I really just, that really just got me interested in just hearing a different language, you know, from basically when I was a baby. And that got me interested got me interested in languages. Watching Sesame Street, seeing Spanish, learning some Spanish on Sesame Street, that made a huge difference. I had a neighbor when I was a kid. She visited Acapulco, Mexico, and she came back and was, you know, brought me a little souvenir, a little t-shirt, and she, you know, that had an influence on me. And I don't know, I mean, the list is endless, but I can think of one person. There's one instance when the first day I ever taught any class, it was at West Virginia University. It was in 1997, August of 1997, and I had never taught before, and I was extremely nervous. And I must have smoked half a pack of cigarettes. I walked around Woodburn Circle, I mean, several times, and was just smoking. I was just shaking. I was so nervous. And I went and I taught my class, and I was terrified. But somehow I got through it. I survived it. And after the class, I went up to the office with the other graduate instructors. And there was a woman, her name was Kathy Copenhaver, and I just remember her name. She's a veteran instructor, and she came up to me and she said, how'd it go? How was your first day? And I told her, I said, you know, I was really, really terrified. I was scared to death. I thought I was going to wet my pants. And but for some reason, like, when I was in front of the room and I was standing there, I felt like I belonged there. And she said, that's because you do. So that was, at that moment, I knew that I was a teacher.
Wow. Yeah. So if a person were watching this today and they said, you're living the life that I want, like, you're doing it, what did you do to align yourself to get there?
Huh. Well, you mean how did I end up at this point in my career?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, so I have a bachelor's degree in Spanish from West Virginia University. I grew up in Morgantown. I was very fortunate to grow up in a college town. And I was always Mr. College. I feel like I was born in college. And so I got my bachelor's degree in Spanish in 97. I got a master's degree in linguistics from West Virginia University in 2000. And you know, during my master's program, I taught. I was a graduate instructor. I taught Spanish for those 3 years. So I got really good Spanish teaching experience. And after that, I enjoyed the language so much, I wanted to learn more. So I decided to get a PhD, not because I thought it would look good, or, you know, it would sound nice, be called doctor or whatever. I really just genuinely wanted to keep studying, and I wanted to get a terminal degree in Spanish. So I went to the University of Texas in 2000, and I got my PhD in Hispanic linguistics from the University of Texas at Austin in 2007. And I stayed there and worked for 1 year as a course supervisor, and I taught a linguistics course, taught a course in practical Spanish phonetics. And I also taught community college when I was there. And after that, it was time to leave Texas, and I was at Penn State for 2 years, and I was a lecturer there. It was an adjunct position. I taught intermediate Spanish courses there for 2 years. And then I got laid off. The stimulus money ran out. It was during the Great Recession. So I started looking for jobs. I was desperate. It was late in the year. It was summer. And I did not know where I was going to end up. And I looked and looked. I applied for 13 jobs. And they all shot me down except for one. One day I was at Walmart. I was in the parking lot. I was driving around and I get a phone call. It's a 606 number. And I'm like, is that Arizona? No, that's 602. I'm like, what's 606? So I answered the phone. It was Pikeville College calling me. So they interviewed me. They liked me. They said, you know, how would you like to build a Spanish program? I was like, wow, that was like a dream come true. So I came here. Ella Smith, the other Spanish instructor, she's now Dr. Ella Smith. Ella Smith Justice. She was working on her PhD at Ohio State, doing her coursework. So I was here to basically hold down the fort and help build a Spanish program while she was gone. And by building the Spanish program, I thus created a position for myself. So I was here for 5 years. And when 5 years were up, at the end of 5 years, I was ready to leave. And it was just time to move on. And so I started looking for jobs. And at the time, the school had UPike had a lot of strong connections. And Pikeville also, as a town, had some strong connections with China. And while I was here, I became very interested in China. And it was just one of those, I just had this, I don't know, it was just a feeling that I had. I felt really good about that. Just something was just drawing me to China. And I had a few opportunities. I had an opportunity to work there. It kind of fell through. So I started searching for some jobs. I took a teaching English as a foreign language, a TEFL certification course. I took that. And, I could have just gone on and just been a professor, a Spanish professor somewhere else in the U.S., but I always had this yearning, this deep desire to live in a foreign country for a long time, to learn another language besides Spanish, and to learn a lot about another culture. So, you know, I'm in my 40s, I'm still not married, don't have kids, you know, I'm like, hey, why not? You know, it was just time to just rip the whole thing out and start over. And I didn't even know if I was going to continue teaching, but I knew that I was going to leave and do something. So I thought I was going to teach English. I put my resume out there. I get an email from Donald J. Holder. He was a principal at the Affiliated High School of Peking University. He liked my resume, and he said, how would you like to work at a high school? And my first thought was, well, I'm not sure, but we discussed the terms of the agreement, what the school was like, and I became very excited, so I agreed. So I worked there for a couple of years. I continued to teach Spanish, and I became interested in advising research writing. When I was a professor, I didn't have the opportunity to advise a whole lot of students research writing, and something I always kind of wanted to do, because I've published a book and it's been very successful. I republished my dissertation as a research monograph, and it's been very successful. It's been cited a lot, so I'm capable of doing research, and I'd like to share that gift with other people. I would like to encourage others to do what I've done and to try to make a difference in their field. And so I got the opportunity to do that with these high school kids in China. I got to help them learn how to write a 4,000 word university caliber research essay with a thesis statement and supporting argument, and to look for sources, search for academic sources and to cite them correctly. And I just really enjoyed doing it, and that's a task that I think most teachers don't like to do. Like, most teachers really don't enjoy doing it. Most students really don't want to be taught that, but I really enjoyed it. I just that was my niche that I found in China. I needed to find a niche. It was not teaching English. I never got the opportunity to teach English. They needed a Spanish teacher. I was there. It's a lot of people teach English there. Not so many teach Spanish. So, you know, I'm a native English speaker. I can speak Spanish very well. I have experience teaching Spanish. And, you know, lo and behold, I enjoy teaching research writing. So it was just the perfect, you know, everything just aligned perfectly. I rebuilt the research writing program at that school in Beijing. And I was there for 2 years. And then I moved to Shenzhen in Guangdong province. Like I said, it's right next to Hong Kong. It's extremely hot and humid there. It's basically a sauna. And so I worked at the school there, and I helped them. You know, I wrote the curriculum for, it was a brand new school when I got there. I wrote the curriculum for their research writing program. And you know, starting this coming school year, I'll be the director of institutional research. So what I'll do there is I'll be, you know, coordinating the students' research writing. I will be assisting in faculty development and helping the, you know, my fellow faculty with their research needs, or any, you know, anything they need, really. And also to establish the institution, to establish the school as a research institution, to help make connections with other institutions of higher learning, other research institutions, you know, locally and, you know, within Guangdong province, within China, and, you know, throughout the world. So that's how it all happened. Everything just, you know, there have been different twists and turns. Naturally, I was born to be a linguist. I realized later in life that I had a gift for teaching, and I have a gift. I just love to travel. I get restless. I can't stay in one spot for very long. And like I said, I just want people to get along and people to understand each other. I want people to be able to communicate with each other in a civilized manner. Sometimes we kind of lack that in our own culture of late. And I just think that everything just kind of lined up perfectly. So I just, you know, I'm just doing the best I can. And, you know, when I see people achieve their full potential, that just makes me feel really good. And that's, you know, then I've done my job. So that's kind of it.
Now, as a teacher, you've had all kinds of conversations with students since 1997, teaching your first class. Mm-hmm. When you have a student now, or a person who's just dealing with you in your life, and they say, I just have no idea. It's like no idea what I should be doing. What advice would you have for them?
That's kind of a tough question. When a student says, you know, I'll ask them. I mean, I'm not a college professor anymore. I'm a high school teacher. So the students that I teach, I work in, I teach in an international track. I work at a Chinese high school. It's a unique school. It's a Chinese high school that has a Gaokao track, the Gaokao is the Chinese national college entrance exam. And so we have those students, and then we also have international track students. So the international track students, they will be attending a college or university in another country, most likely an English-speaking country. And we also have a Bard Early College program. And so most of the students I talk to, the students I work with the most are the international track students. So a lot of times when they don't know what they want to do, I'll just tell them, okay, well, just ask them questions like, you know, what do you like? What is it that you like? Okay, some of them might say, you know, I like basketball and video games. I'm like, okay, what do you like besides that? I mean, you could maybe do something with that. I'll ask you, okay, write a list of things that you like. Just start writing stuff down. Put pen to paper. You know, what are some things that you like to do? And, you know, for example, if you like, you know, some people might like basketball. You know, a lot of kids like in China, they love basketball. They love the NBA. So sometimes, you know, I'll say, you know, maybe you know, could be interested in sports medicine or sports management, something like that. I mean, even if you're not going to be, some of them, you know, they say, I'm going to play in the NBA one day. I'm like, well, it's not easy to get into the NBA, but you could do something that, you know, you could get a job that, you know, in that field. You know, some students will say, you know, they enjoy video games, and they're like, well, okay, well, maybe you could, you know, become a programmer. Maybe you could design video games. There are lots of things that you could do. So what are some things that you like? You know, if they say some of them like animals, maybe they could be interested in veterinary medicine. something like that. So just basically, it's like, you know, what do you like? You know, think of it. Think of some things that you like, and if you're not sure what you like, just, you know, where would you like to live? A lot of students know that, you know, they know which country they want to live in. You know, so, okay, so, you know, a lot of Chinese students, they want to live in California. And I always tell them, like, we have 49 other states, okay? So, right, so figure out where, you know, if you figure out what it is that you want to do, try to look for schools that might offer a program in something that's related to what you like to do, that you're interested in. If you're not sure what you want to do, figure out where you might want to live. What is it that you want out of a college? You know, where would you like to live? Say if you want to live in, I don't know, New England or California or somewhere, start looking at schools. Start, you know, we have the internet, the World Wide Web. You know, start looking at, you know, start looking at universities' web pages. Get, you know, try to see, you know, what type of programs that they offer. You might see something that catches your eye. So, like I said, just, you know, figure out what it is you like, where you want to live. I always tell my students, you know, pick something that you want to do. When I have to do the when they do the research, I say pick a topic that you don't. Excuse me. Pick a topic that you want to do. Pick something that you like. Okay. Pick something that you like. If you pick something that you don't want, or that maybe your parents want you to do it, or it's like the cool thing to do, or it pays the most. If it's something that you don't want to do, you're going to be miserable, and you might not carry through with it. You might not follow through with it. Let me see if I can remember the Confucius quote. Something like, if you have a job that you like, you'll never work a day in your life. Something like that. So pick something that you like. So that's, you know, explore what that is. And I always tell them, like, you know, even if you don't know exactly what you want to do, and you know that you're going to go to college, then, you know, just get into college, get your foot in the door, and just, you know, get those core requirements out of the way. Sometimes it takes a little while to figure out exactly what you want to do. But if you're going, you know, but, you know, college is expensive. If you need to borrow money, borrow responsibly. If you're not sure, you know, college is not for everyone. You know, don't be in a hurry to do anything in life. You know, don't do something until you think you're ready. So, you know, college is difficult, you know. Life is hard, college is harder. So that's all I got on that.